On October 2, 2023, there was a special day for Indonesia that made everyone in the country super proud. It's the day when the Indonesian president officially launched something really cool, the Jakarta-Bandung high-speed train. This train is a big deal because it's the first one of its kind in Indonesia and all of Southeast Asia. It's like a big leap into the future for how we get around. Imagine this train zooming along at a super-fast speed of 350 kilometers per hour. That's faster than any other train in the southern part of the world. It covers a distance of 142.3 kilometers, connecting Jakarta, the capital city, with Bandung, the fourth largest city in Indonesia. So, it's going to make traveling between these two cities so much faster and easier. But here's the fun part: Indonesian President Joko Widodo gave the high-speed train a really cool name. He called it Whoosh. He said it was inspired by the sound the train makes when it's speeding along the tracks. This is a standout project that brings together China's Belt and Road Initiative and Indonesia's Global Maritime Fulcrum Strategy. It's a shining example of practical cooperation between China and Indonesia. This HSR also marks a historic milestone, as it's the first time that China's railway systems, technology, and industrial components have been put to full use in constructing a high-speed rail project overseas. Is the Indonesian HSR a debt trap by China? In a nutshell, the answer is a resounding no. The Indonesian government's decision to collaborate with the Chinese government on the high-speed rail (HSR) project was far from foolish. They carefully weighed the benefits for their country and ultimately made a wise choice over Japan during the project bidding process. First and foremost, the financing aspect played a pivotal role in President Jokowi's decision to opt for China for the high-speed train construction. China's financing proposal was undeniably more favorable for the Indonesian government. This was mainly because Indonesia wouldn't need to dip into its state budget. Instead, China would shoulder the financial burden through a business-to-business cooperation arrangement. On the other hand, Japan's proposal placed a heavy burden on the Jokowi administration. Japan would only proceed with the project if certain financial guarantees were provided, and the project's risks were to be borne by the Indonesian government. Secondly, according to Rini Soemarno, the Minister of State-Owned Enterprises, China's commitment to technology transfer had the potential to bolster the Indonesian railway industry in the future. This meant that Indonesia would be directly involved in every aspect of the project, learning from China and gaining the necessary technology for building and maintaining high-speed rail. In the future, if Indonesia fully mastered this technology, they could even assist other countries, such as Malaysia or Thailand, in building their own HSR systems. Furthermore, Indonesia aimed to balance the influence of Asian superpowers as a small nation. They adopted a hedging strategy, not aligning exclusively with one party but rather opportunistically embracing both China and Japan. In the midst of China and Japan's competition for influence in Southeast Asia, this was the most effective approach for ASEAN countries, including Indonesia. By taking a look at a certain graph, one can observe how China's economic influence in Indonesia gradually began to challenge Japan's dominance. Finally, it's important to clarify something about the so-called debt trap often associated with China. Some people say that when countries borrow money from China and struggle to pay it back, they're caught in a trap. But this idea is misleading. It's like getting a loan to buy a car and then having the bank take the car back if you can't make the payments. It doesn't mean the bank set a trap. Countries borrow money to build things like infrastructure and boost their economies. This happens all over the world, with countries like Japan helping India build high-speed trains or organizations like the World Bank loaning money to developing nations. The Jakarta-Bandung Railway is $1.2 billion over budget. The Jakarta-Bandung HSR was initially supposed to cost $6.07 billion. However, in 2022, Jakarta announced that they needed an extra $1.2 billion to finish the project by the planned launch date in 2023. The main reasons for these delays and extra costs are problems with acquiring land and pandemic-related disruptions. Critics argue that the HSR is only 142 kilometers long and won't make enough money to justify the investment. But it's important to understand that not all public infrastructure projects need to turn a profit to be successful. Public transit systems, including high-speed rail, often operate at a financial loss. Indonesia didn't just want this project for a fast train. The real goal was to learn the technology, skills, and operational know-how. They aim to eventually build and run their high-speed railways and trains independently or at least become skilled in parts of the process. Furthermore, infrastructure projects like the HSR bring enormous economic benefits. They boost the economy by connecting cities and regions, leading to more trade, tourism, and investment. High-speed trains are also much faster than regular trains or roads, making life easier for commuters and businesses. The Jakarta-Bandung HSR will cut travel time between the two cities from 3.5 hours to just 40 minutes. Another criticism is that the HSR is relatively short at 142 kilometers. But it's essential to think about the future. Connecting Jakarta and Bandung is just the beginning. China and Indonesia are talking about extending the HSR from Jakarta to Surabaya, which is over 700 kilometers away, across the island of Java. When the Chinese Premier Li Qiang took a ride on the trial run of the bullet train a few months ago, they discussed extending the HSR line, and the Chinese Premier supported the idea. Right now, they're studying the feasibility of extending the HSR line further. It's true that the Jakarta-Bandung high-speed railway project ended up costing more than initially planned. The budget went from $6.07 billion to $7.27 billion, even exceeding the Japanese government's initial proposal of $6.2 billion. However, this doesn't necessarily mean that if the Japanese had undertaken the project, there wouldn't have been a cost overrun. The initial cost proposed by the Japanese was already quite high. If the project faced challenges like land reclamation issues and pandemic-related delays, it could have led to even higher costs, just as it did with the Chinese-led project. And don't forget that the proposal from the Japanese requires the Indonesian government as a guarantor. What's happening with India's high-speed rail supported by Japan? In India, they are still working on the Mumbai-Ahmedabad high-speed rail project. People are comparing it to Indonesia's HSR project because they both began in 2017. Both projects have faced controversy and public debate because India chose Japan as its partner, while Indonesia went with China. Although these two HSR projects differ in length, Indonesia's is 142 kilometers and India's is 508 kilometers. They both experienced cost overruns and delays, especially India's HSR. The main issue with India's HSR is land acquisition, which has significantly slowed down progress. According to India's Railways Ministry data, as of May 2022, only about 20% of the physical work has been completed. Initially planned for completion by 2023, India's HSR project has faced multiple extensions, and India has announced that the completion of the project will be delayed to 2028, another 5 long years. And the project is likely to continue beyond 2028 if the current pace persists. The cost overrun for India's bullet train project has reached 1.67 rupees lakh crore due to higher land acquisition costs, increased input costs, fluctuations in the yen exchange rate, and GST. This situation highlights the significant challenges a country faces when undertaking a massive infrastructure project like an HSR. Malaysia and Singapore also launched an HSR project connecting Kuala Lumpur to Singapore a few years ago, but it was cancelled due to a change in government and the high cost involved that caused national debt concerns. Future of high-speed rail in Southeast Asia. In the last 10 years, Southeast Asia's economy has grown rapidly, attracting billions of dollars in foreign investment in businesses, real estate, and infrastructure. High-speed rail networks are a major focus of this investment in the region. However, building high-speed rail networks in Southeast Asia is challenging due to the time, cost, and labor involved in large-scale infrastructure projects. Regardless of whether they are built by China or Japan, high-speed rail will play a crucial role in the region's economy in the coming decade, with the most significant impacts on trade, tourism, and rural communities. The new rail connections between Malaysia, Thailand, Laos, and China will enhance trade by reducing transportation costs and increasing efficiency. They will also bring tourists to less accessible areas in these countries. Rural communities near these rail lines will benefit from increased revenue from hospitality services during construction and new job opportunities after the projects are completed, thanks to improved connectivity. While there are uncertainties about the future of high-speed rail in some parts of Asia, it seems that high-speed rail is here to stay in the region. What are your thoughts on Indonesia's new high-speed rail? Do you believe it will boost the country's economy, or will it lead to more debt? Please share your opinions in the comments below. If you enjoyed this video, please like and subscribe to our channel for more interesting updates on Asia.